curious here, who has maybe a brief thing they'd be willing to share, a particular situation that was challenged, just a little bit about the situation, and what was the challenge to your teacher? Don't all be bashful here. Just got one that they might be willing to share here. Yes?
I had a situation with a student with anxiety who did have an accommodation letter, and she had flexibility with attendance, and she was not present many days. And the problem I dealt with was not so much that she eventually would get the work done, so it wasn't really a problem with her, but the problem was with the other students in the class who felt like it wasn't fair that they had to be there and somebody else didn't, and I couldn't explain it to them, obviously for privacy reasons. And so they just felt like there was this, you know, unjust sort of situation, unjust situation in the classroom.
Okay, very good. So in part, we're going to be talking today about some students with anxiety and depression. A subset may be under the AARC and have accommodations, others won't, but an issue either way, I think you're pointing out, is the perceived inequity by other students in the classroom for what they're seeing kind of that person do. Okay, maybe one more story? Well, that's just one that was kind of a challenge to how you do your teaching.
I can say that because of arranging field trips to Chicago and students filling out forms and getting medical history, I've seen that sometimes 50% or more of the students I'm dealing with are being treated by some kind of medication. That was really eye-opening to me. And so very regularly, we have people who are making plans to study abroad or do other things, and then suddenly something falls apart. And I hear stories from students. It's become a regular feature of my planning with students, my interaction with students, that they're feeling not stable and able to do things they've been planning just a year before. And it's really varied. Sometimes it's someone's in crisis and comes and opens up about it, and I see progress. Other times, someone's very quiet, and then big crises that happen, but it's just a regular part of my teaching experience and advising them.
Okay, so it's often something that's either is there and it's kind of ongoing, or it emerges and it's a new thing, but something that can be there. And as you spoke about with students going overseas or for trips or whatever, stability can be a real concern for that. So I'm sorry that it's not going to be on the wall for you to go ahead and see here, but I want to talk to you about the five goals that we have for today here. So, and this is going to be interactive. This first part of the presentation will be a little bit more didactic, but we'll have a point or two of then some time for reaction and interaction with that. And then we'll get a little bit more interactive when we get to the parts about what you can do to support students with anxiety and with depression. So goal number one here is to learn information regarding students' significant anxiety and depression. So we're going to share with you some statistics nationwide and also at VU and help you differentiate what is clinical anxiety and clinical depression from having some anxiety, some nervousness, and having some sadness or depression. And then we're going to secondly then look at how these symptoms do and do not relate to accommodations in the classroom. So we're going to make a point about, you know, what is the connection? Is it a close connection? Is it not a close connection? Thirdly, we're going to talk about how to provide support while maintaining rigor. I think how many of you have heard the terms grit or resilience? Okay, so I think the perspective of us in the counseling center is that we in college, this is a critical time for people to learn grit and resilience, because once they're out, once they're working, they're not going to be told, well, you don't have to get your work done, or you can have double time to get your work done. Once they are out, they have to meet the requirements of whatever they're doing, whatever job performance things they have. And so our job is to help the students then learn grit and resilience so that in spite of having anxiety or depression, that they are able to go ahead and achieve things. The next goal then is to learn appropriate campus resources for these students, so we'll do some sharing about that. And then we're going to learn how help you learn how to talk to and refer to a student in distress to the appropriate resources for that. So if you think a little bit about college here, college is a time of discovery, and this will be kind of the context, and you're all familiar with this, but college is a time of discovery and excitement. And it's a time of personal, intellectual, psychosocial, relational, occupational, and moral development. In fact, there's more change that happens at this stage of development than in any other of the developmental transitions across kind of the whole lifespan. So as a result of that then, some students feel overwhelmed, some feel homesick, some experience difficulties socially or with time management, some, but not all. And some other students kind of more develop behavioral problems. So they may suffer from alcohol abuse, they may suffer from eating disorders, sexual assault, family problems, health issues, and the death of close others. So some of these things represent behaviors of acting out, some of them represent situations that then impact them. All of these situations, though, the normal developmental stuff and then the situational stuff, all these then may evoke a wide range of responses. So they may evoke kind of mild anxiety and depression, all the way to severe depression, clinical anxiety, suicidal or homicidal thoughts, and disabled kind of functionality for that. So to differentiate a little bit in terms of what clinical anxiety is here, the anxiety disorders are a set of mental disorders. They're characterized by significant feelings of anxiety and fear. And in psychology, the discrimination is kind of this, that anxiety is a worry about future events, and fear is a reaction to current events. So anxiety is about future, fear is kind of current. It both feels about the same on the inside. These feelings may cause physical symptoms such as a faster heart rate and also shakiness. And we got it up. Good. Okay.
Move back.
All right, very good.
Sorry.
Yeah, good.
All right, she took
the okay. Okay, all right. So we all good so far? Okay. All right, so if you look then at clinical anxiety here, there are kind of a number of common things that people have. And if you look at the anxiety disorders from the what we call the DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, which is about now 800 pages. The original one was 53 pages. So there's everybody now is diagnosable with something. So at any rate, though, if you look at the anxiety stuff, there's some common symptoms that play out for this. So panic, fear, and uneasiness, sleep problems. And you can see how the sleep problems become cyclical then. Can't sleep, then you get more anxiety, kind of disturbs that more. Not being able to stay calm, cold, sweat. May have a shortness of breath, tingly feet, hands. You may have heart palpitations, dry mouth, nausea, tense muscles, dizziness. Now, if you look at these, a lot of these have some physical elements. So there are different ways then that you can look at this. So one way to look at this, or how people who work in the field look at this, is to look at clusters of how these symptoms kind of play out. So a lot of the ones previously then tie into this first cluster, which is the psychological symptoms. So some people with anxiety, and a lot of people have comorbidity on anxiety and depression, they have both, but sometimes one is really prone to one, really prone to another. But with high anxiety, it's not uncommon to get a lot of these things for that. So at the Counseling Center, we use an instrument called the CCAPS. It kind of assesses generalized anxiety and separately social anxiety. Those are very commonly elevated scores on the people that come into the Counseling Center, that you see one or two or both of those kinds of anxiety for that. But there are psychological symptoms then. So there could be excessive fear or worry, kind of racing through decreased concentration, memory, irritability, impatience, indecisiveness. And particularly the concentration one is one that can really play havoc then with kind of academic success. And then there are behavioral symptoms. One is avoidance of situations. Somebody who, you know, they don't go to class, they get, you know, then they feel shame about not going to class, then they don't go to class the next day because they had shame about not going. Now it's 2 days, now it's 3 days. And so they get an avoidance going, and when they make that decision not to go to class, they get a decrease in anxiety momentarily. And in psychology terms, that's called negative reinforcement. Having a decrease in something distressing is reinforcing. Matter of fact, it's more powerful than positive reinforcement. And so one of the things that's kind of puzzling often to the person themselves is, why am I doing this? It doesn't make sense. But they're actually being reinforced because of those micro choices, even though in the longer run, it's really tremendously self-defeating. They may engage in obsessive or compulsive behaviors, may have distress in social situations. So when people have high anxiety, sometimes you see it's playing out in one of these three dimensions when they have high clinical anxiety. Sometimes it's in two, sometimes it's kind of in all three. And so it plays out uniquely for each person. And then from a clinical perspective, depending upon the exact kind of nature of the cluster of anxiety, it may be panic disorder, it may be social anxiety, it may be generalized anxiety. Within the field then, we divide clinical anxiety into a number of different discrete categories depending upon kind of the pattern of symptoms that are playing out for that. Okay, so looking at it as college student health issue here, anxiety issues have taken over as college student the most largest health concern nationwide. So if you look at this field over for a long time now, college mental health, depression was kind of here, okay? Anxiety was here. Depression has not gone down. Anxiety has gone over, okay? So no decrease in depression, but leapfrogging anxiety. Let's get a quick thing here. Why might this be the case? Any ideas?
Economy.
What else?
Parents.
Parents, maybe? Okay. Any other ideas?
Maybe because of technology, just constant influx of information, being told to do something and being fragmented. And
okay, bombarded with technology, you know, it's like never, not spaces for rest. Okay. The American Psychological Association, I'll add one more that this room will resonate with. The American Psychological Association does an annual survey on stress in America, and we now have some of the highest ever, and the major contributor now is politics. Okay, that kind of what's going on in that. It's kind of, people may not even be talking about it at all, but it's kind of playing out and kind of going for that. So if you look then at the demand for services here, that continues to increase. So since 2010, nationwide, the demand for services at counseling centers rose 30%. At VU, it's risen 35% since 2010.
Stuart, are there any demographic differences in populations?
Yes, I mean, I think for all of us who've been here for kind of any prolonged period of time, the nature of the student population here is definitely changing. Whether that's contributing to this, I'm not sure there's a causal connection, but we definitely have a far more diverse kind of population. I guess I smile with it a little bit. I've been here for a very, very long time. And when I came here, everybody had a name like Cressman or whatever. And that we get names at the counseling center now, we don't know how to pronounce them. So they're very diverse in terms of the student population now. And whether that's added to that or not or different, I don't know. But clearly it's a different group that way. Okay, so clinical depression here. Now everybody is, you know, if you ask people, have you ever felt depressed? I think every hand in the room would go up. And all of us have felt sad, depressed, down, whatever on that. But clinical depression is kind of defined specially. So it's a more severe form of depression, also known as major depression or major depressive disorder. It's not the same as depression caused by a loss such as death of a loved one or a medical condition such as a thyroid disease. It plays out kind of in a more clinical way, and let me go into that. So this may be difficult, but a little difficult to read. I think the print's a little bit smaller here, but these are all of the kind of qualifiers. Now, the way the DSM works is you don't have to have all of them, but generally speaking, the more of these to have, the more intense the clinical depression is and the more intense that these things are. So you have difficulty concentrating, remembering details, making decisions. Obviously, that would impact academics if someone had that particular symptom there. Fatigue, decreased energy, can't get up, feelings of guilt, helplessness, feelings of hopelessness and pessimism, insomnia, early morning wakefulness or excessive sleeping, irritability, restlessness, loss of interest in doing things, even things that were pleasurable, can be overeating or appetite loss, persistent body problems like pains, headaches, cramps, persistent sad, anxious, or empty feelings, although many people who have clinical depression don't recognize it because that's the part they don't have. They don't feel sad, they just don't feel anything. And so sometimes they're surprised when that's what turns out to be kind of maybe the situation going on because they don't have the cue of a sad feeling that might cue them that that's what's going on for that. And some have thoughts of suicide and suicide attempts and some do not for that. So these are the symptoms then of clinical depression, and looking at a little bit as a college student population, nationwide, this is the number two concern. 49 of the presenting issues nationwide are represented as having kind of elevated clinical or diagnostic depression. And a greater number, I think was picked up earlier in the comment over here, a much greater number of students come in now with college with a significant history of mental health treatment, inclusive of receiving medication. Now, there's a couple of reasons for that. One could say, wow, more people, must be more messed up people, okay? But there could be some other reasons. One is that this country has been working on destigmatizing mental health for about 15 years now. And actually, it's been successful. I think mental health is talked about, we're talked about here on campus, it's talked about a lot of different places, and so I think it's just received a lot more attention over a fairly prolonged period of time now. So I think people are more likely to recognize something and to talk about something. A lot of the prevention programs in junior high and high school are recognized, you know, that we're focusing particularly on suicide prevention. When a friend has or a peer has, you know, something, report it. So there's been a lot of attention given to get your friend to get some help for this. That may be one reason. Now, the second reason is the medicalization of period. You know, many of you may not know this, but the United States is the only one or two, it may now be the only one country that allows advertising of pharmaceuticals on TV. No other country in the world, or maybe it used to be New Zealand, I don't know if they still do or not, allows that. And so if you look, for example, at the 5:30 news, every commercial is a pharmaceutical. And so the message is better life through chemistry. And so in some ways then, there's been this view of somehow medications can help with these problems. And so part of this is parents are concerned, they want to their children to do the best as possible, and it ties into this. That's just one of the things. And if they've been developed, you know, obviously there's been a lot of work to develop medications to try to be helpful as well. So in combination with that, those things are kind of coming that way. So if you look here, particularly at the Counseling Center, then looking at the data from last year, we provided over 2,500 intakes and follow-up counseling sessions last year, and over 250 psychiatric sessions that we provided for that. Almost all of these people had anxiety and depression as one of their two issues. Some had maybe other issues as well, but the vast majority, this is kind of like the majority of the stuff that comes in has one or two or both of those things. And of the clients that come into the counseling center, approximately 30% had received medications as an augment to the psychotherapy that they are receiving. To kind of share a little bit with you about that, because of the research and we base this on this, we do not provide medication alone. Because the research is clear when it comes to depression and anxiety that the more effective treatment is therapy, psychotherapy, and if needed, psychotherapy and medication. All the evidence says that's the way to go, not medication alone. So we do not provide medication alone as a service. They need to kind of get the combination because of that. Also, in terms of our providers, they rely on us to do a lot of the work. They and then can just focus very, you know, pretty quickly on the medication aspect. Okay, I want to do one slide and then let you have a chance to reflect at your tables on what's been presented here. But if you think about, you have a group of students in every class that you have, and it seems like some have a lot going on and they're coping with it. It seems like others maybe don't have as much going on and they're falling apart. And it's like, why might this be the case? And so one of the models that psychology has is called the diathesis stress model. And what it says is that you got this level of current stress in the middle. But what happens is that each person comes in with a level of existing psychological skills and personal and social resources. Also, each person kind of has a set reactivity. How many of you have who have children have two or more children? Okay. Are they identical or different? Okay. All right. So there's something about emotional reactivity that tends to emerge really quickly in life. That seems to be some are high reactors, some are more chill, kind of from the get-go. But beyond that then, because of developmental experiences, family experiences, other experiences, some develop kind of much better coping skills, much better personal resources, or have a better support network, others don't. And because of that then, that ratio then determines then the probability of developing clinical symptoms. Those that don't have as much of the assets on the top, in the same situation will develop more symptoms. Those who have more resources will probably have more grit, more resilience, and more likely to be able to withstand a higher level of stress and kind of not kind of fall apart with that. So I've thrown a lot at you so far. Why don't you take a couple minutes at your table and just kind of share reactions, thoughts to the kind of things we've had so far.
Overall. Yeah. Probably not. That's what I'm curious about. one year, like in Minnesota. Whether sometimes one is a trouble in student cases, depends maybe the students didn't have access to resources to help them previously, and it's been in a situation. I know that we've had students that have seeked counseling here, they're out of their parents' home because they don't want their parents to know.
No,
there's
and
still
it's
that
more private
at the home,
here,
right.
Yeah, whereas some families might not be open to it.
Right, right. So I do kind of wonder. At that college level.
I wonder if they do like a survey or something that look at that. That would be something to look at.
Yeah.
The other thing kind of related to that. How much do the parents know? I mean, like, I know I kind of come from, I'm in between the generations, and so, like, you know, I had to solve a lot of my own problems, but there are a lot of help that parents are solving for them. And so, when they're put in situations where they actually have to solve their problems, especially going to college, you know, I wonder if that was why partly increases
as a parent of a freshman in college, can see like how I definitely think that that's part of it.
Yeah.
Part of it is, you know, I know you are as a parent, you want to protect your kids
sure.
as much as possible and all of that.
Let's go ahead and take a second here. Any comments, any questions? So, any comments, questions? I think one I overheard was about cigarette smoking, and by the way, it was a psychologist. His name was John Watson, who developed behaviorism that developed the slogan, "Walk and walk a mile for a camel." He went into marketing. Not all psychologists turn out good. Okay, comments, questions? Yes. This is my opinion of that. I think I see kind of the trend toward that. And I think sometimes people come in and they're just using the medication that tends not to be enough. Normally, if people are going to develop grit and resilience, they typically are going to need more than just a medication to develop that because there's all these psychological skills and coping skills that they typically don't have. And some can learn that on their own, but often they need some assistance in learning that. So that they're more able to, again, handle the same level of stress in a more adaptive way. That's a good comment. Yeah.
Wouldn't it be considered best practice to have the combination of for all the medical care?
I think
so
that
people
would,
who are coming in without any counseling, whoever is prescribing things is really not conforming to best practice.
Generally speaking, that would be there. The research shows that for some people, medication can help relieve these symptoms faster. But that there's a cross point where therapy then crosses the effectiveness and becomes, becomes more effective over time. But for some people needing more quick, you know, if you don't have time in the semester, that can be really helpful to get started on medication very quickly. Typically for us in the counseling center, we'll start in therapy first and then make the decision after therapy starts about whether to go that way. But again, if somebody's coming in with something that's working for them, we'll get them started pretty quickly.
I might add on, it really is, I'm going to move up here and sleep with you guys.
There are some clients that I see, and probably within the first session I can say that they need some type of medication, just because the physiological symptoms of whatever they're experiencing are so pronounced that their depression is that severe that they're having a hard time getting out of bed in the morning. So they might need that assistance because of that physiological aspect of their anxiety or depression that needs to be relieved, because it's very hard to learn coping strategies. Coping strategies are hard. It's a very difficult thing to just say, I'm gonna get out of bed, I'm gonna put my pants on, I'm gonna go to class. Not when you're clinically depressed, not when you are, you know, have a generalized anxiety type of issue that's gotten that severe. And so many times the medication will decrease some of the physiological symptoms so that now they are better able to learn and then utilize the coping strategies. So it really depends on the severity of the student and the symptoms that they're showing and manifesting. That I might be like, we need to get into that appointment right away, especially if someone's telling me I'm having three panic attacks every day. and I can't take my exams because I'm having a panic attack every day. Well, there are medicines that can immediately can help with that, and so it depends. So there is a time and a place for medication, and for some people that do have very chronic mental health concerns, depression and anxiety, they at one point might not be in therapy anymore, but to not be on medication would be, you know, detrimental to their life. And so for some people it is just medication. It depends on the individual, it depends on their diagnosis, it depends on the symptoms that they are presenting. But, you know, with what Stuart says, a lot of times I think the first thing for people is to say, is there medicine or some type of thing that is just going to take all of this away? But medicine in and of itself is not a bad thing. It's actually very helpful. So.
Yeah, I got one more, but I really want to support what Lori Gunn has said on that. The other comment is that with the medications, with the research, if you think about physical, mental, and emotional, it's the physical, the physiological that they best get at. It. So, she said, well, you know, sometimes you've got to get that right away. Do one more slide, and then we'll turn this over here. Here's the connection then to functionality. The World Health Association has kind of what they look at in functionality. They have these domains that they talk about, which if you look at that, you know, these are things that are pretty important. If you think about it being kind of a continuum here, some people, you know, are maybe very low or non-existent almost on any of these to people being very high functioning. Now, if you think about it in an academic context, what is it? It's doing your homework, doing your problems, going to class, taking quizzes, studying for tests, taking tests, writing papers. You know, these are the things it requires for academic success. So in a sense, the functionality of the student is related to doing tasks like that. So I think when you're looking then at anxiety and depression, I think a couple points to make is there is not a direct correlation between having a clinical anxiety and or a clinical depressive kind of experience and any particular kind of dysfunctionality. Okay, it may play out in a variety of ways. And so what's needed, and this is what school psychologists do, is that they, or clinical psychologists, they will do it actually quite a number of hours of testing, talk to collaterals, talk to interview people, because to really know what accommodations are needed, you really have to know where the functional disturbances are. Then you can kind of base accommodations on very specific in-depth assessment of what is needed. Now, you know, in terms of AARC, and they do presentations, but that when someone goes into AARC, they can get temporary accommodations for that semester when it comes to anxiety and depression, and they talk to them and they kind of base what they recommend upon best sense about what could be helpful. After that, then, what is needed is they have to go through this in-depth testing and assessment so that, for example, if not being able to not be at class is an accommodation, that needs to be assessed as there's a very good reason for that being a particular accommodation. So just want to make a point here again, there's not a direct connection between levels of anxiety and level and depression, of specific functional impairments when it comes to the academic task. That's why, again, kind of a lot of assessments required for that. And going back to one of the first things here, ideally we're all, even with these things, with or without, we're working to help students develop grit and resilience because that's what they need to develop in order to be successful here and in order to be successful at the next step. So, yes?
So for a student who's going to get this extensive testing, who pays for that?
I think that's a challenge. One of the challenges is that some students are very limited in their resources and the institution does not pay for that, there are not grants for that, so I think that's one of the things that's a real hardship in the system. Some students come in and they've been extensively kind of tested in high school.
Right.
They come in with an individualized educational, an IEP, mm-hmm. and it's been tied to particular accommodations. That's an easier situation because maybe it's already been tied with some of these accommodations, it was that. I think the more difficult challenges is when that hasn't happened. And sometimes anxiety and depression, if you look at all of the mental health disorders, age 19 is actually the prototypic level for the psychiatric diagnosis to emerge. So they can emerge earlier in life, they do for some people, but for many people they don't emerge until they're going through this developmental transition into college because it's such a tough transition. And the stress of that, plus some other factors, sometimes that's, it doesn't emerge till then. So it's a more tricky situation.
I think one thing that would be helpful, and I know there are schools that do this, where they, the student actually can put it on their bill,
mm-hmm.
and it's just like tuition, because if the student in the middle of the semester is falling apart and $3,000
yeah.
cash,
right.
you know, that's
right. very difficult.
Most students,
yeah, and again, I think that in part they do temporary accommodations so that someone can
right.
get something immediately, but still, it's a financial thing. One more question, then we'll turn it over. Yeah.
Does your office have a listing of medical professionals that do that testing in the area?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. There's a couple that do this in the area for that.
Okay.
And so, yeah.
Thank
yeah,
you.
But, okay, well, let me turn it over to Laura.
Generate a list for me before I get into PowerPoint slides. But what do you see? What do you notice in your students academically, behaviorally, physically? What do you notice in your students that seem to be in distress? What are the things that jump out at you?
Absences.
Yeah. Okay. So the behavioral one, frequent absences, and that kind of goes into that avoidant response.
Anger.
Okay. Can you say more about the anger?
Usually it happens like if they have something due or they get feedback from the professors and they come in and they're overly angry about something that seems pretty simple to fix or, you know, pretty...
A little bit of an irrational
yes.
response
yeah.
to something.
Sure.
Anything else that you notice in your...
Not responding to emails.
Decisions, you know,
mm-hmm.
missing a class where there's a lot at stake and it's really obvious the person could have been there, or could have done one little simple thing, just not doing it in the bothers a lot. Why don't people see that one?
Absolutely. So it sounds like people see a lot of avoidance, whether it's coming to class, missing an important assignment, or not responding to an email and just kind of falling off the radar a bit. Okay, so what we're going to talk about a little bit is maybe some other things that you can look for before they just fall off the radar. Did you want to comment? Okay.
Personal hygiene.
Yes.
Goes out the window.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's talk about some of these things. Okay, so here's some academic indicators. So probably none of this is used here, right? Deterioration in quality of work. So you have a student that's been doing really well, and all of a sudden, you know, over time, you start noticing that what they are completing is starting to deteriorate. I won't go through every single one of these things, but missed assignments, repeated absences from class. You might, in some of the classes, see that some assignments might start indicating feelings of depression, suicide, despair, anger, based on their writings. You might notice something like that. The continual seeking of special accommodations. That's a big one that happens, I think, in the classroom. May I have an extension? I had some things happen this week and I'm not going to be able to get that in on time. I have an extension for this. And then that extension goes by and then something else has happened and they're asking for something else. Or may I take the exam at another time? And so just that repeated asking of some type of special accommodation to be able to get through the class. And not participating in group projects with other students and in general just not participating in the class at all. So some of these things, as you can see, you might start to see a pattern for, especially if it's a student that's normally present in your class and normally completing their assignments, and that starts to change. Behavioral indicators, okay. Anger, hostility that seems unprovoked, yes. So anger is also a symptom of depression. So a lot of these, what seems like irrational responses to things. So they don't do well on an exam, and they're very angry about that, or a poor grade on an assignment. And they just seem a little bit more angry than what the situation would call for. You might see more severe things, such as threatening other people in the classroom on the internet, impulsive behavior, or acting out, okay? And so this might be a student that normally you know, participates well in class, you know, polite, able to assertively discuss their thoughts and opinions, and suddenly they're attacking other people in the classroom and getting into more arguments, okay? So that's something that you might see. Also becoming more withdrawn, so they're getting more quiet. You notice that they're not talking to anybody in the classroom anymore, and they're not making eye contact with you, okay? And on the flip side of that, someone that starts to show a little bit more energy than they used to, and they're talking more, and being a little bit disruptive in the classroom. And then again, into distorted thinking, we do have some students that will experience psychotic symptoms, particularly at this time in their development. You can see the emergence of thought disorders, schizophrenia, psychotic aspects of depression. So sometimes you can see distorted thinking, and it just doesn't seem to make any sense what they're asking you. Crying often, being alone, and seeing the student a lot on campus in isolation without peers. Right. Lack of personal hygiene, not showering, being in the same set of clothes every day, and they don't appear to be clean. Okay. They're very tired. If you find that someone is now falling asleep in the class very frequently, and that's unusual for them, this is a physical indicator that something is going on with them. Attending class feels bleary-eyed, intoxicated, smelling of alcohol or drugs. Aware of that as well. Signs of self-injury or self-destructive behavior. So you might notice that if somebody is cutting on themselves, and you might see scars on arms or wrists, or you might have another student that reports this to you. So these are just a few things to kind of keep an eye out for with your students, okay? Because I think the earlier that we can start to recognize some of these behaviors, then you're able to talk to them, try to figure out what's happening for them, and then get them to the right people for help. Yes?
Can you give an example of disordered thinking?
Yes, and that could be trying to think of a perfect example. Maybe they comment to you that that they feel that they have been graded unfairly, that you told them that the assignment was due on a certain date, like a month from now, just completely just irrational, things that don't make sense, okay? That they feel like other people in the classroom might be out to get them. That's like a distorted thought of paranoia, okay? So things just don't seem to be based in reality. Or if they're talking to you and they're moving their ideas, shifting ideas quickly, and they're not really following a logical sequence. Okay, so that kind of distorted thinking. Okay, so those are the more severe ones that you see. Anything that I didn't put on these lists that you see with your students are asking? Crying. In class?
In the office.
Okay, in your office talking to you. Yes. So I know that you know that everybody has a lot of things going on, and your primary purpose is to be instructed in that classroom. But getting to know your students and being attentive to their behaviors in the classroom can go a long way in identifying a problem at the beginning before it becomes a crisis. Many times by the time they get to the counseling center, things have become a crisis. Things have gotten to the point where it's very difficult for them. So the more people in the community can be keeping their eyes out with the students and recognizing some of these things and reaching out and saying, hey, are you okay? And let's try to get you to the right place, you know, the better it's going to be for them. So, how to talk with a student in distress. Has everybody in here talked with a student who's been distressed about something? Yes, okay, what do you find to be difficult about talking with them? What are the challenges?
I'm not respecting privacy.
Okay, all right. So do you feel that sometimes that you feel hesitant to ask certain questions because you feel like it might not be my business to ask that? That's intruding too much, okay, anything else?
Ones that some that I've interacted with, you can kind of see.
see some signs of it, mm-hmm. and they're not willing to share first and kind of creating that comfortable enough space to be like, hey, why don't you come to my office? And then finally, when you get him in there, then sometimes you're able to kind of break down some of the what's going on, but kind of just getting that first step. Try and better understand where you're at so that you can, you know, overcome whatever obstacle seems to be in the way.
Absolutely. And that first move cannot be overstated. It's so important to just make that first move. Hey, you know, it seems like something's happening for you. It seems like something is going on. Would you mind coming to my office? Can we schedule a time to talk? You can write it on a paper that you're returning back. I think something's happening. I care. May we talk? Okay. But taking that first step to initiate a conversation with a student, okay? Because more often than not, they're not going to. Many of them are not going to approach you first, okay? So it's really important that when you see that it's happening, that you make the effort. So some tips for how to do that. So accepting and respecting what is said. Just let them speak. Just hear what's happening for them, even if it seems a little distorted, a little bit irrational, a little dramatic. It's okay. Just listen to them. Just listen to what their experience is and just hear what is being said. Okay, that is the first step. Without judgment, without commentary, just listen to them. Okay. As they are talking, try and focus in on an aspect of what they're talking about that is manageable, okay? Because I find with most people, and particularly with adolescents, and that's kind of what we're talking about, adolescents and young adults at this point, is that there tends to be one manageable problem, and then it escalates into this huge thing that they don't know how to fix anymore, okay? And they've created this very large beast. And in listening to what's happening for them, try to listen for the little pieces that there can be a solution for that you can focus on. Okay, so as they're talking about all these problems, try and hear what the primary thing is. What part is manageable? What part can we create an action plan for to try and repair this? Okay. Help identify resources needed to improve things. So know your campus resources. Know the counseling center, know the health center, know the academic resource center, know how to access tutoring, okay? So it's important to know what all of the campus resources are, their phone number, where they're located, how they can contact them, okay? Because, you know, many times when people are anxious, it's hard for them to solve problems, it's hard for them to find information because their mind is spinning. You don't have to do it all for them. You don't have to make the phone call for them. You don't have to do that. You don't have to get to your computer and pull it up all on the website, but you can give them some instruction as to where to find it, okay? But know what the resources are, okay? Because that helps them try to, again, put an action plan together to solve a problem. Help the student think of things that they have done in the past to cope with a similar situation, okay? So, you know, when you were, in years past, did you feel really anxious during an exam? Did you feel like you weren't competent at handling the material? Did you have situations where you felt socially uncomfortable and that you couldn't talk to friends? What did you do? Did you do anything to cope with that? What were helpful things that you have done? Because it's amazing how quickly they can forget how many coping skills that they do have in similar situations that they have used them in. Okay, so help them kind of think back. If you've been in similar situations, what did you do? What was helpful? Let other people know your concerns. So I know it's easy probably, you know, to hear a student's concern and then you just kind of keep it to yourself. Okay, but I think it is important probably to share it with other people in your department. It's important to share it with the counseling center. It's important to share with a lot of people on campus. So the more people that know that there is something going on with the student, the more people that have eyes on them, the more people that are watching. The more people that can help them, okay? But there are many situations where I will be working with a student, contacting a professor, and then suddenly I've talked to four different people, and everybody's having the same experience with this person, but nobody is talking to each other. And the minute everybody starts talking to each other, then something can be done to help them, okay? So please, like I understand the confidentiality piece, and I think I'm gonna get into it, I don't know if it's on this slide, but another one, there it is, yes. Do not promise secrecy or offer confidentiality to the student. there is a reason for that, okay? Because if we start offering all that confidentiality and I won't tell anybody, you're limiting the help that they can receive. This is not helpful for them. It's also putting yourself in a dangerous situation, okay, to provide a level of secrecy if somebody could be doing something that could hurt themselves or another person, okay? I think that it's appropriate to say that they can trust that you will share the appropriate information with the appropriate people to try to best help and serve them, okay, and explain that, because I think many times students worry that people will be gossiping about them or saying negative things about them. So please let them understand that if you have to share this, it's with the intent of helping them and that you care about them. Encourage them to encourage students to seek help. Okay, that seems very, very basic, but many students are not very skilled at help-seeking behaviors. And I think someone asked about demographics. Okay, so you know, based on, you know, there are many international students that do not engage in help-seeking behavior because that is not part of their cultural experience with mental health issues. So there are many students that do not know how to engage in seeking help. They might have experiences in the past where they have asked for help and it has not gone well. They might be afraid that their parents may find out and have all sorts of reasons why they want to keep it confidential, okay, and don't want to seek help. So encourage them that there are people, there are places that can help them with confidentiality, okay? So getting them over to the counseling center, helping them understand. And respecting their value system, even if you don't agree with it, okay? That's, you know, it's not gonna be helpful for anybody if you are arguing with them about what they perceive to be a problem in their life, okay? You're in essence telling them they're wrong. That's not helpful, okay? So just listen, try and find that manageable piece, get them to the right person for help, and above all, express that you care. I can't say that enough, how much it is so important to let them know that you care about their success and getting help. Okay, so we do wanna touch on working with a student in crisis. So for us, a student in crisis is somebody that is a danger to themselves or other people, okay? So that's how we look at the word crisis. There might be a student that is feeling very anxious and very sad, and they're crying and having an anxiety attack. But that, in our mind, that's when we hear crisis, we immediately think danger to self or others. Okay, so that is the word crisis for us. And you will see students that are in crisis. You will have them in your rooms. So a student in crisis is someone that necessitates emergency care. Okay. So let's just start from the bottom. So somebody is threatening harm to somebody else. Okay, that is a crisis. That needs immediate attention. Somebody that is expressing suicidal thoughts. Okay, they do not have to have an intent or plan, but they are expressing suicidal ideation to you. Okay, because you're not counselors. Okay, that is something that should require immediately contacting somebody. Okay. The others, inappropriate communications, loss of contact with reality, that's getting into more kind of psychotic symptoms where they don't know who they are, okay? They might think that there's somebody else. They might think other people are out to get them. If you start seeing things like that, that needs immediate care, okay? Contact the UPD, okay? That's, you know, sometimes we'll get emails counseling center that says, you know, that a student's expressing suicidal thought. Well, that email, by the time it gets to me, I can't go get to that student anyway, okay? So somebody is in crisis and is exhibiting any of this. Really, the first place that you can call is just the UPD. They will come, they will assess the situation, and they will, if the counseling center is open, they will bring them right to the counseling center, okay? So do not, you know, don't stop, just call the UPD. Okay, they will come, they will assess the situation and get that person to safety. Okay, and that's 24 hours a day. All right, I think that's probably the best thing to do. You can also, if you're with a student and it doesn't feel like it's quite this nature of crisis, you can pick up the phone, you can say, let's call the counseling center right now. You can talk with, there's somebody on call every hour from 8 until 5, except lunchtime, 1 will close. But there is somebody there that can, consult with you, okay, and explain what resources we have and how to make an appointment and what things that you could say to that person. So please call us anytime, and we're happy to consult with you about how to help these students. A little bit about suicidal thoughts and behaviors and warning signs. So the obvious, threatening to hurt and to kill himself or herself. Talking and writing about death and dying. They express a lot of hopelessness. Dramatic changes in mood, and that can go either way, okay? Somebody who's very depressed becomes very energetic. Someone who is very energetic and talkative can become more depressed. So it's just a change in their mood. If they start expressing no reason for living and no sense of purpose to you. Many times when I talked about finding that piece of their problem that is manageable, okay, they feel like there's no solution to whatever that problem is. They might be talking about a problem, there's nothing that can be done about it. There's no solving it, there's, you know, there's just no point in being here anymore, okay? These are warning signs of suicidal behavior. What to do? Ask immediately. Are you having thoughts of wanting to hurt yourself? Are you having thoughts of wanting to kill yourself? You should practice saying that. It's not something to say. Okay? I don't really enjoy saying it either. But you have to ask that question, and you have to ask it directly, just like that. Not, you know, you're not having thoughts of wanting to hurt yourself, are you? Why do you think that that probably would not be the way to go about asking someone? You know, but people do because they're afraid of that answer. They don't want to get it. And so now you're asking them to argue with you. Well, yeah, I am. You know, so ask directly, because I tell you what, if someone isn't suicidal, they're going to tell you immediately that they're not. And they're going to say, oh my gosh, no, I would never do that. That's not what I mean. And then you can, you know, you were saying some things that were concerning me, and you sounded hopeless about the situation, so I want to make sure that you are safe. I care about you. I care that you are alive. Okay, so ask the question directly. Again, tell them that you care and that you want to get them to help. Okay, which is for you is going to mean getting them. Yes.
Okay, so you said when a student's in crisis,
yep,
call the UPD.
Yes.
Can you elaborate on that? Because it sounds a little oversimplified, like, the classroom and the office, like,
well, sure, sure. So, okay, so if you've got somebody in your office, okay, and you're talking to them, and as that conversation starts to come out, they start expressing feelings of helplessness or hopelessness, and they feel like their life is not going well, it's not going to get any better, they're not sure why they're here anymore, and you start to have some thoughts like, this is making me feel a little bit uneasy, that maybe they're thinking about not wanting to be alive anymore. So the next step would be then to ask them if they are, okay? And then in talking with them, to make sure that they are getting to help, okay? That's where you might say to the student, will you walk over to the counseling center right now, okay? But again, you might not know. I'm thinking of this from your perspective. You might not know that they got there. And you can call and we wouldn't be able to tell you that, okay? So. You might want to consider calling the UPD and say, listen, I want to make sure that you get over to the counseling center to get some help because you're expressing suicidal thoughts. I'm going to call them, and they're going to make sure that you get over there, you know, to schedule an appointment. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So okay. It's not like I'm pushing a secret button and the student has no idea, and then the police show up.
Let them know. Yeah.
I think if the counseling center is open,
And you can absolutely do that. Sure. But we have had situations where that doesn't happen.
Right.
And now there's the student that's just out on campus, and then people can't find that student. And so best judgment for yourself. If you can walk them over, great. If you think that you can trust that they will get over there, absolutely, okay? But I also want you to protect them, because we wouldn't want them to not and then hurt themselves and, you know, for yourself and your own peace of mind, okay? A lot of times emails can come through after hours and you're not on campus anymore. You can't talk to them, okay? So that would be a situation where I might call the UPD and say, I got this email from this student and I'm concerned about their safety. Would you go check on them? Okay, and then we'll go do a wellness check, okay? Don't wait until morning to check it out. If you do You can let them understand, you know, thoughts of suicide are an aspect of depression, and it's treatable. You can get you help. And that people do have thoughts of suicide. They're not that uncommon, okay? But you don't have to act on them. So many, many students experience suicidal ideation on a daily basis, okay? They're not acting on them, but they do have those thoughts and they're looking to cope with them. So that is correct. Okay. Again, to be redundant, remain calm, know who to call for help, okay? And that's why I say put the PD in the top of your list, okay? Because that's going to be immediate at any time of day or night, okay? If you're with somebody and you need to get help, have someone stay with the student. Don't leave them in the office alone because they could leave. So have someone be with the student while you're calling. You're calling the counseling center or calling what it's like. If a student starts acting like they are a direct threat to themselves, or starts to act in a bizarre, irrational, or disruptive way, and you're concerned for your safety, and they're not making sense, and they're sounding paranoid, again, call 911 because they probably need to get to a hospital immediately. And contact us at Counseling Services. Any questions? Yes?
Two questions. So what is the number for UPD? And have we had suicides on campus?
Have we had suicide? Okay, so DUPD, I think if you call 911 on campus, it will immediately route you to UPD. So you can just call 911, okay? Mm-hmm. Have we had a suicide on campus? Not that I'm aware. We have had, yes.
But not on campus.
So there have been people that have killed themselves, yes, that have been faculty or students, but we have not.
No,
had an on-campus suicide.
Actually, I think we actually have a remarkably good record here, and I think that's because of people like you that are here on that. So over the past 30 years, there's been one staff member, a pastor here at the chapel that suicided, and then there was one student last year who was a transfer student. Those are the only two that I'm aware of in 30 years. So we've had people attempt. But in terms of completed suicides, those are the only two. And again, statistically, that's way below the national averages. And I think there's a lot of reasons for that, campus size, the caring nature of this place, and so forth. But one's too many.
You mentioned
within July,
the Counseling Center will be making those checks for students. And what is the procedure for asking for that? Can any faculty member ask for that?
Yeah, we just call the RSC. I would imagine if you can call Ryan Cummins from Lincoln's office and get the RLC and they'll go knock on the door. And they are all trained as well in getting the student to help.
I'm wondering what conversations you've had with administration in terms of growing your own support. I mean, 8 to 5 with the lunch break seems, it doesn't even cover our class hours, let alone when students might most need it. I don't know how, I mean, I know our budget situation.
Okay, so one of the things I think that we're real blessed with here is that, because we're at the undergrad level of, you know, pretty heavily residential campus, and so we have a residence life now. It's a professional residence life. That wasn't always the case a number of years ago. And so they all have training in terms of being supportive for this. And so they work as a team, particularly with the UPD after hours. And so that's the vast majority of the times when they're after hours, it's because of that. And typically what needs to be happening at that point is kind of an after hours kind of assessment by usually the ER room. They have staff that are trained to do kind of assessments, and either somebody is deemed safe to be released, or they are hospitalized for a short period of time, typically, to do that. In addition, there are national hotlines that we share, that we post around. So there's a number of posters around campus with the National Suicide Hotline. There's other lines. There's a crisis text line that we may be exploring now about being able, that students might be able to access after hours and on weekends. so that there can be these places to go ahead and to get help in that particular way for that.
Thinking even less about the immediate need of something like someone who's suicidal and more about the wait time that you might be experiencing. I mean, I've heard lots of things from my own students about how I can't get in for another week and a half. Or,
right.
So I'm thinking more about staff.
Okay. Yeah, and I think that's an ongoing issue, not only for VALPO, but for most every university across the country for that. I can say that what we do is we have a crisis hour. We try to have a crisis hour every hour of the day, with rare exceptions. And so if somebody is a danger to self or others, we will see them immediately. We also assess kind of level of stress, and if the level of the stress is at a certain point, even if they're not, we'll still see them immediately for that. So there are services available, and we do a screening whenever the contact is made on the spot at the time. So a screening is done with the student to assess whether that is needed. We then have developed a lot of resources to try to give people help while they're waiting. I think most of you have heard about Towel Connect self-help. And so that's kind of like their immediate things to kind of like provide people some help that's immediately available. We've worked hard on our website to have resources on the website. So while it's not a direct person that immediately intervenes, there are resources available that way that we continually try to kind of expand. And then we always shoot to try to get time to intake in kind of as reasonable time as possible, and then intake into therapy after that. But that's kind of the way we're trying to balance everything with what we're trying to do. But it's an ongoing challenge.
So one group refers you to further services. Change in personality, again, refer them over to the counseling center. Okay? So if you start noticing that they're becoming more quiet, withdrawn, and depressed, as well as showing more energy, refer them to the counseling center. If they begin to display aggressive or abusive behaviors to others, loose or incoherent thought patterns, again, referring them to the counseling center. Signs of depression, and I think we went over all the depression and anxiety, but these are all times in which it would be appropriate to refer someone to the counseling center. In addition to those, though, eating disorders. They start talking about unusual eating. You notice if somebody's lost, a significant amount of weight or gained a significant amount of weight, and they're talking about fainting and not eating enough. An appropriate thing to refer to the counseling center. Showing signs of injury to self. So maybe you are seeing scars, or other students are reporting it to you that they know that somebody is engaging in self-harming behaviors. They're deteriorating academic performance. Send them over to the counseling center. Drug use. We have an office of alcohol and drug education with a licensed substance abuse counselor. Okay, so we do provide specialized therapy for those. Issues and making statements of suicide, homicide, feelings of hopelessness or helplessness. There's never an inappropriate referral to the counseling center, okay? So in the end, if you have a concern about somebody's well-being, refer them to the counseling center so that we can talk with them and assess what's happening for them. There's never a wrong referral. Yes.
Can you offer some suggestions as to how a conversation like that should go if they haven't actually spoken to you at all? So, are we supposed to wait, aren't we supposed to kind of wait for a student to come and talk to us before we say, hey, I think you could benefit from it. So what's the scoop on that?
So, when I was talking about identifying the different signs that you might see in your students, it's about you taking a proactive approach and reaching out to them instead of, because they may never come to you. So if you are starting to notice behaviors, and other, academic performance, physical hygiene issues, anything that's causing you concern that has you questioning whether they are struggling with a mental health concern, talk to them. I see that something's happening for you. I notice that you haven't been in classes regularly and that it's taking you longer to finish your assignments, but you've just been looking really tired lately. I notice that you're falling asleep a lot in class. I care about you. Talk.
right? And then many times in getting them into that private space, you know, and again saying, I care, what's happening, would you like to talk about it? And then they might share with you what's happening for them, and then you can make the referral. Yeah, I think the important thing is reaching out to them.
Can you clarify, by referral, I understand suggesting to the student that going to the counseling center would be a good idea, volunteering to bring the person over or facilitate that. But is there ever, is referral ever our contact in the counseling center and saying, I'm worried about this person, and this person, I talked to the person or haven't or whatever, given the person's not interested in coming necessarily.
Yes, okay, so.
But I'm worried, so.
So a couple things. So we can't obviously force someone to come. So when we get a call, we can't like go find them and say you should come in. However, it is always good to call and let us know if there's student concern, because we will take that student's name and we will take that student's information. And we hold on to that data, okay? And then as we might hear of other things, or they eventually walk in through the door, now we have some history on this person. And so we can help with that. Now, if you are also concerned about, because of the nature of our role, we are bound by a different level of confidentiality than maybe some other offices are at the university. So if you are concerned about somebody and you don't know what's happening with them, you can call the Dean of Students if you want to and express a past concern, or Compass. I don't know the referral for Compass, Stuart, you probably would have that information to express if there's concern about a student, because there are other people on campus that are able to also reach out to that student, their advisor, too. Okay. But yes, always you can call us if you take that information. Yeah.
Yes, you mentioned something very interesting. What is the relationship between your office and the examiner's office? And when we go to him first versus you first? So up there, for example, I see making statement regarding homicide. I mean, that falls into a counseling realm, but it also falls into the realm of the students, I would think. So what is that relationship like? And how do we, when do we do both?
I would do both, okay. And in terms of our relationship with the Dean of Students, we have to have release of information to share things with them unless somebody is, you know, the only time that we can break confidentiality is if someone is in imminent danger to themselves or others. And trying to prove imminent danger to self or others can be a challenging thing to do. And so that's why I say, talk to each other. Don't just hold on to information about students that are concerning. Share it with other people so that more people on campus are aware and able to help. Yeah, because there are students, certain things that the Dean of Students Office can do that the counseling center can't. And that starts getting into other issues about students becoming disruptive to the campus community and other students, and so that's what I think it's probably helpful for the Dean of Students Office to know if it's causing a disruption.
And I would add to that that we get a lot of communications from the dean. So when you let inform him, he would just say, don't know if this person is or isn't client, but here's some information. And as Lori said, we record it, we make a record of all the contacts we get, and depending on whether they are a client or not a client, we keep them either way. If they're not a client and they become a client, they all go automatically right into the file immediately. And so it's very helpful to hear on that. But we're very constrained by what governs us as counselors and psychologists, that imminent is a high standard to break confidentiality. And so somebody simply expressing that they have suicidal ideation is not warrant breaking confidentiality for us. So
I have one more thing to say, this is kind of off topic a little bit. But in terms of communication with people, it's always okay if you know that one of your students is meeting with a counselor. And you know that because they've been open with you about it and that they are seeing somebody and you have questions or concerns, you may say to the student, hey, would you mind if I consulted with your therapist so that I can kind of learn how best maybe to help or support you? And the student may say yes or no, but all they have to do is come to my office. This has happened before. Hey, I need to sign a release of information for my professor. They would really like to talk with you. and consult about how best to support me. Sure, absolutely. Sign the release of information and I will talk to, you know, anybody that they've given me permission to best support them and to put a plan together to help them. So never be afraid to ask them if they'd be okay with you talking to the therapist. If they have any concerns about what we would share, they will let us know. And we will share what they have given us permission to share. So you can assure them that they can discuss the limitations of that information. Okay, we can get release of information to speak to you. So that could be helpful as well.
One more question.
Just clarify confidentiality with parents. Where does that start and end?
18.
Okay.
Yeah. So without a release of information, we can't confirm or deny to a parent that they're being seen either.
Yeah. So we have a very similar conversation with parents, like if they ask exactly this. So a couple quick things. We're going to get these slides to you, so don't worry about recording everything, because we'll get that to Cynthia, and she will distribute that to everybody. And what we're going to do, we want to make sure to allow time for the last few questions, comments that we have here. I'm just going to run through a couple things pretty quickly here. We've talked about most of these. We just talked about confidentiality, and we talked about, again, kind of consultation. We are very available to you. If we're not available, there's not a counselor, when you call, we'll get back to you in a prompt way. A counselor will call you and try to be helpful in whatever way that we can be for that. I think we kind of covered the other things here. I think, again, one thing we haven't covered is if you encourage somebody to come to the counseling center, you can walk them over. But the other strategy is ask them if they would mind if you called the counseling center and handed the phone to them. That's a real effective way to go ahead and do that. Most will say yes and allow you to do that. They know their schedule, we know schedules, we can work it out. Okay, now I think this goes back, I think, to the one question that come up here. Obviously, if somebody's suicidal, homicidal, they're going to get help immediately. It's the people below that. People with high anxiety, high depression, but don't meet that threshold, waiting maybe to get in that intake. So these are the things that are kind of available to them. The Tao Connect, I've talked about it. It's on our website. Just direct the student there. You can pull it on. They can sign up. Once they sign up, it's their own account to get to anytime that they want to. Also, we have the Stress and Anxiety Reduction Training Room. It's a space in the counseling center. A student can call and arrange for a half hour time to come in and learn about different methods of stress and anxiety reduction. It's a very calm space as it is, so some students just use it for that to help kind of calm themselves down. It's very quiet. Then we've worked hard with our web-based. If you go to psychological resources on the www.edu/counseling website, there are psychoeducational materials, there's mindfulness apps, there's music and relaxation apps, all targeted to the college population. I think we've talked about most of these resources. I think these are ones you have there. But beyond this, there's the Dean of Students. If they're in a dorm, and you know they're the residence hall, and you know the RLC. So whoever you would think, it could be an assistant dean, could be an academic advisor. There's lots of resources around, again, all the stuff on the academic side. And I think what we want to do now, Ben, is we have just a few minutes left here, so we want to make sure you have any final questions and also any comments that people have. So what are comments or questions that people have about what Lori and I have presented today? Yes?
So one of the things that you suggest we do is remind students of previous coping mechanisms they've used.
Exactly.
Are there any coping mechanisms that you can recommend to us that we suggest that they try?
Okay, well, I think one that is helpful to many people is just deep breathing. Just breathing, just trying to take, sometimes just set your cell phone for, have them set their cell phone for 5 minutes and do nothing but just relax, breathe. Because if you focus on the breathing, you're not gonna be focusing on anxiety or depression, just on breathing, so that's a good one. Again, I think alerting them to these resources, encouraging them to, there's a ton of stuff out there that they can kind of get exposed to. There are many people who maybe aren't going to be comfortable coming to the counseling center, but they are going to be comfortable engaging in technology to help. And so that's why we've kind of been oriented toward developing the technology stuff, because for many people, they might have a preference to get help in that way, beyond it being available 24/7.
I think it also depends on the symptoms that they're showing. One of the biggest things that you can do to help is that the first thing that seems to fail with anxiety, depression, or whatever is just sleeping, eating, showering, and exercise. Just like
very basic needs. People stop taking care of those. It's the first thing that goes is that. I'm working with someone that's very depressed or anxious and they're tired. How much have you slept? Did you eat? I haven't eaten in like 2 days. You know, have you gotten outside to move around? So I know it sounds very simplistic, okay, but just taking care of your basic needs is a great first place to start.
I'm just wondering what your opinion is on the accommodations that students get. I mean, I know it's not your choice, but kind of, you know, how those are worded, but you know, the chance to have flexibility with attendance or to leave the classroom if things get unmanageable. And just can you just talk about, with those accommodations, if you think they
You know, the accommodations can be needed. I think Stuart and I probably share the same opinion on this. However, we're trying to teach people how to cope with depression and anxiety, and so the way to cope with that and to improve that is not to then just avoid it, right? So to me, some of that flexibility and time to do things is really it's not helpful. Because the whole goal is to be at class every day. The whole goal is to get the assignment done. You know, that's what we're trying to get to. So that's what I'm working with them on.
I think I want to go back to the one point, though. There really is a multitude of years of special education and school psychology that it's not like, oh, you have some anxiety, you have some depression, therefore you get this. Like, it really, to have appropriate accommodations requires a lot. It requires careful assessment, as with lots of things that require thorough investigation to come up with the correct kind of response. Yeah.
I know some of my colleagues have expressed skepticism about the flexibility in attendance. And this last semester, I had a student in that accommodation, and that was one of the provisions. And this student stopped attending and would text me, you know, 5 minutes before class, I want to get to class, but I'm having a panic attack, and I just can't make it. And that student actually then pulled out and did really well in class. And so I think it's data point of one, that there are cases where if I throw a line in the sand, it's
going up. Okay. And I'm actually going to point out Kevin here, because he's got the right role, talking to you in your role, that I think if faculty have concerns, I think working through the appropriate faculty kind of body to kind of interface with AARC would really be, I think, the correct conversation.
What I was just going to comment, I have had a conversation with AARC, and they both want to dialogue with those who are facing these issues because of some of these concerns, and they understand that, and part of their role, at least as the way it was communicated to me, is that the faculty members should not feel obligated to help the student make up the work, because when they're told about these accommodations, the onus is on the student, but absolutely they want to work with each individual faculty members and departments, and we're starting to do that in some small ways before kind of trying to maybe launch that in a larger way, to dialogue more about these so that we understand them more, especially before we all of a sudden just see them on an accommodation layer. So we are working through some of those, but even more dialogue now with individual offices as appropriate to be. And so I was going to suggest, call Zed, have a conversation, because he would look forward to that.
And to provide some context here, because I'm pretty familiar with school psychology, is that if you look at the whole thing of special ed and accommodations, it was for other, you know, things like reading, writing, other things. This thing with psychiatric ones is a relative newcomer on the block. So I think there's still a lot of working through with these, because, you know, if somebody is in a wheelchair, okay, they have to have handicap access. It's much tougher. And so I think it's still a lot is kind of still in development. Yes.
This is sort of just a comment, but we've had a lot of success with students that have anxiety to help them develop a planning method. We find that oftentimes, like, the students that come in that are sort of showing high anxiety signs, we can say, okay, well, get out your planner and we'll sit down and we'll talk about, okay, where are your, you know, big dates this semester where things are due, and then we can kind of work backwards from there. And for a lot of those students, just having a handle on where that need, like, where their work needs to go and when they need to have that done and making to-do lists really helps them move forward, you know, rather than, like, staying in one place, really.
No, very good. I think Lori earlier talked about break the big thing into something manageable.
We've been encouraging, because I, technology is sort of the bane of my existence sometimes. So I've been having my students buy planners. Get back to the paper pencil, make it, put it down on the paper, make to-do lists, cross things off. That way you feel like you're moving and not just looking at everything.
Waiting for the reminder.
Yes, yes.
Very good. Maybe one more here to be mindful of time.
Oh, I was just going to ask, do you have any coping mechanisms for us as we deal with some of these things that, you know, we've not gone through counseling training? And, you know, what are good things that we can do for ourselves after, you know, maybe after something's happened, maybe it's at the end of the session that we kind of need to.
Can I just follow up on that? That's the question I have, and that's the question about boundary keeping for faculty.
Yes.
What is our appropriate role as faculty, not as members of the counseling center, but as members of the faculty? How do students respect those boundaries? How do we respect those boundaries?
Okay, let me do two quick things here. In terms of Kevin's thing, I would say the self-care stuff is important to be doing, really helpful. And one of the things, the Tao Connect is actually here due to funding of the donor, and so we got you all thrown in for free. And so there actually is quite good stuff that's on it to help you kind of cope. All the things I talked about for students are there for you. So you can log on to that. I think the boundary thing, and again, I want to go way back historically, the role of faculty has actually changed a lot through the last kind of 100 years, 150 years. And so at one point, lived with students and were quite kind of involved. We've gone through this period of high specialization where here's your job, here's your job. Student affairs was developed out of specialization. And so I think now there's kind of like this, you know, kind of like, well, it's more than just being in front of the classroom. And I think struggling with a lot of faculty, I think it's a struggle to what is my role here? How far, what am I supposed to do? And I think it is a challenge.
So coping strategies for yourself, I think the biggest thing is to remember that you're not gonna fix it for them. And you can't. I think that so many people are, you know, you're well-intentioned, right? And you really want to see them succeed. At some point, the student has to do the work. They have to make the choice that they are going to utilize the resources that have been provided to them, that they are going to use the coping strategies that have been taught to them, and so there is a limit as to how far you can go in helping them and reminding yourself of that, that really the best you can do is be aware, right? Look for those things, try and reach out, offer help, offer support, offer care, offer resources, and that's all anybody can really do. Some point they have to decide whether they are going to make the effort to do it or not, to help themselves.
And I would add that even if they're not able to do it now, getting an exposure now may serve them later on. All right, well, we want to be mindful of your time. I think this is when this is set to close. So we're thank you so much for all of your attention and today and all your contributions. And again, we'll send out the like Cynthia. She'll distribute this to all of you. So best of luck through the remaining kind of months of the term and to us.